Thank you. thorns grew up and choked it. But some seed fell on rich soil, and it produced fruit, 100, 60, or 30-fold. Whoever has ears ought to hear. The disciples approached him and said, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He said to them in reply, "Because knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven has been granted to you, but to them it has not been granted. To anyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. From anyone who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables. Because they look, but they do not see, and hear, but do not listen or understand." Isaiah's prophecy is fulfilled in them. It says, "You shall indeed hear, but not understand. You shall indeed look, but never see. Gross is the heart of this people. They will hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and be converted, and I heal them. But blessed are your ears because they see, your eyes because they see. Blessed are your ears because they hear. Amen, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see, but did not see it. Hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear the parable of the sower. The seed sown on the path is the one who hears the word of the kingdom without understanding it. And the evil one comes and steals away what was sown in his heart. The seed sown on rocky ground is the one who hears the word and receives it at once with joy. But he has no root, and it lasts only for a time. When some tribulation or persecution comes because of the word, he immediately falls away. The seed sown among the thorns is the one who hears the word, but worldly anxiety and the lure of riches choke the word, and it bears no fruit. The seed sown on rich soil is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields 100, 60, or 30-fold. The Gospel of the Lord.
Who, when they were asked, After spending some time with one of their kids, he ran back to his own house. He was having supper with his mom and dad. He said, "Mama, Daddy, I went over and played at the Allgaier's today. I want to tell you, I think they're rich." And the mom and dad knew that the Allgaier's weren't rich. They were just like everybody else. But they asked, out of curiosity, "Why would you say that they're rich?" "You should see all the beds they have." He also tells a story about trying to save these kids in the neighborhood some money. They were all given a quarter. Little boys ran together. They were all given a quarter to go out and get a haircut. Mom and he thought, "Well, if I could save them some money, I've got some clippers here." And so he took about 3-4 swipes of the first 4 or 5 kids that were there. And he said, after a while, it looked like I was preparing them for death row. And I ended up giving them quarters. And the first boy said, "Mr. Allgaier, what's this for?" And he said, "Get this, go out and get your hair cut by a barber before your mama figures out what we did." His generosity and the generosity of that generation didn't come out of an abundance of money. It didn't come out of a sense of, "You give me this, and I'll then give you this in return." It came out of a sense of gratitude, maybe formed in the womb for them, but definitely honed on their knees each evening, praying the family rosary in gratitude for what God gave them. My great-grandfather, their father, he worked at Fisher Packing for a while. During the Depression and the years after, he brought home the scraps. Everything but the oink, he said. And no matter what they had, there was always room for 2 or 3 or 4 neighborhood kids to come over and share. And I've never met, including my uncle and his brothers and sisters, a truly generous man or woman who didn't say that always he or she received more in return than he or she gave out. And I've never met a truly big-hearted man or woman who lived out a sense of scarcity. To be generous and big-hearted, we have to first trust in God's abundance and in God's generosity. Trust in the sower. Where God is concerned, there will always be enough, there will always be more, there will always be more than we ourselves can use. And what he asks is that we operate out of that mindset. Not as hoarders, not as people of fear, not as people who believe that God rations his love or the word or the life. So when we're looking around, even today, we'll still see people operating out of fear, believing that life is a zero-sum game. If I give, then there will be less for me. God does not operate that way, thankfully. Neither should we. So as we move into the moment in which we see God's generosity most clearly displayed on this table, let us ask ourselves individually, what have we been given? And how do we return it? Tight-fisted or open-hearted? God-like or like humans do? And know that in his economy and in his generosity, there's always room to change from the way that we have been.
Let us now demonstrate our gratitude to this great and loving God as we offer up our petitions and our prayers. For the Church, Pope Francis, Archbishop Kurtz, and all leaders of it. comfort, peace, and reconciliation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That everyone in this faith community, through our witnessing of the mighty deeds of God, may receive the grace we need to place our trust always in Him. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all those who have gone before us, mark the sign of faith, may they live forever in God's presence. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Generous God, bestow upon us this day a gift of gratitude, that we might get an inventory of all the blessings you placed in our hands and in our hearts, and return them gladly to you and to all those who dwell in this world with us. For you are our Father, and our God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many."
presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, Joseph, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin, Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, you may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by the High Teaching, let us be bold now and pray the perfect prayer to give us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now.
Lord Jesus Christ, we said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. In whatever way you are comfortable and available, we may offer to each other social distancing in place.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
The way that the communion rite will work today, the remainder of the Mass, we will stand here in just a moment. Father will give us the prayer after communion.
exits on either side of the gathering space. Kathy will be over here, I'll be over here. The ushers, men's club, by the way, who are here and others, please thank them for their service because they've done an outstanding job this whole weekend making things work smoothly. They will call people from the back forward and let you re-enter, exit as you wish, and receive communion as you leave. We recognize these are uncertain times and difficult adaptations have to happen. We're working with this. We're hopeful and very pleased we've worked great at 8 o'clock, but this will work okay. And soon, we will be gradually making our way back towards normalcy. How long that takes, we don't know. We thank you for your patience, your prayers, and your persistence. Please stand.